And so lattice cryptography, yeah, is a fairly recent area of mathematical cryptography that is typically dated starting with ITA's breakthrough discovery in 1986 that you can build one-way functions, cryptographic functions that are hard to break on the average, based on the worst-case complexity of lattice problems. And so ITA's discovery was used to build a number of cryptographic applications, including hash functions, commitment schemes, digital signatures, identification schemes. But the main reason it attracted so much interest at first was from a complexity theoretic point of view, because it exhibited a connection between average case and worst case complexity. Now, the roots of lattice-based cryptography are, in fact, even before ITA's result. Lattices are closely related to subset sum, knapsack problems that have been studied since the early days of cryptography in the late 70s, when Merkle and Perlman came up with their subset sum-based public key encryption scheme. But there's a notable difference between the use of knapsack and the implicit use of lattices before and after ITA. So in the early days, the connection between knapsack and lattices was mostly due to the fact that you can break the subset sum schemes using lattices. You can reduce the cryptographic function to some lattice reduction problem. So the cryptography is known to be not harder than the lattice problem. So what I did and what's really remarkable about this discovery is that he managed to give a reduction in the other direction, showing that if you can break the certain cryptographic functions, then you can solve lattice problems. And besides that, he managed to give a reduction of the strongest possible kind. He gave a reduction from worst case lattice problem. If you can break the function on the average when the key is chosen at random, then you can solve approximately lattice problems on every single instance. Now, the lattice cryptography as an area really took off a little bit later after another turning point in the study of lattice constructions. And this Oded Preger's discovery in 2005 that there is another problem called the learning with error problems. Problem that is also hard on average, and he could do a proof similar in the spirit to ITA, reduction from worst case lattice problems, but under the stronger assumption that lattice problems are hard not just by classic computers, they are hard even to quantum computers. And what made this discovery so important is that it opens up to a much wider range of applications, including public key encryption schemes, CCA secure encryption, identity-based encryption in the standard and hierarchical form, and even fully monomorphic encryption. That's one of the latest developments, which we cannot quite base yet on this learning with error problem, but sure, it seems at this point that lattices is the most viable approach known today to achieve such a powerful cryptographic primitive. I should also mention that there was theoretical work giving proofs of security for subset sum-based constructions before ITA's work. Probably most notable is the result of Impagliazzo in our showing that you can build pseudo-random generators based on subset sum. But until recently, that was thought to be only applicable to private key functions. Similar, if you want, to those that can be built from ITA's discovery without the RWE problem. So the study of RWE also contributed many interesting ideas in cryptography and subset sum in general. And there's a very beautiful scheme recently discovered by Dubashensky, Palato, and Seger showing that you can build public key encryption based on essentially the same techniques and tools that were already available at the time of Impagliazzo and our discovery that the subset sum problem has good pseudo-randomness properties. And how exactly these subset sum constructions fit into what I'm going to talk about today is not quite clear to me yet. That's probably one of the open problems. But anyway, just to mention it as something potentially related. So one of the nice things about lattice cryptography is that you don't even need to know about lattices to understand how it works. It is based on very simple mathematical operations like linear algebra, matrix vector multiplications with small integers. And these reductions from worst case to average case give you some core average case hard problems, which can be described without explicit reference to lattices. And you can use those problems to build cryptographic functions without having to go through these worst case reductions every time. So in this talk, I will not talk about lattices at first. I mean, the word lattice is everywhere, but I will not mention lattices until later on. And I will first describe these hard on average problems established by Haidai and Regev. And I will show how those problems can be used to build the cryptographic functions, specifically public key encryption schemes. So I will describe two specific schemes due to Regev and the GPD scheme of Gentry, Peikert, and Vakuntaratan. And I will argue that all of this will be described without using lattices, but then I will argue that you really need to talk about lattices to understand those constructions and understand how they relate to each other and what's really going on. And I will give a brief introduction to lattices, and also specifically the dual lattice, a very important tool in the study, geometric study of lattices. And using the language of lattices, I will go back to the cryptographic constructions and show how random lattices and constructions can be explained using duality. So let's start with lattice cryptography without talking about lattices and hard-on-average problems. So with these two problems, Haidai's problem and the learning with errors problem. So the problems are very simple. So in Haidai's problem, you are given a matrix A, which is an n by m matrix with entries modulo q, where q is a small integer. Think of q as a single word integer, nothing like factorization like primes. Q doesn't even have to be prime, it's an arbitrary integer, but it can be useful to think of it as a prime, just to make things look nicer as a linear algebra over a finite field. So you are given a matrix A, which is a short and fat matrix, it's larger than taller. And you're also given a vector X, which is a 0, 1 vector, with as many coordinates as the columns of A. And or more generally, you can think of X as a short vector, a vector with small coordinates. Now, Haidai's function, what it does is simply a matrix vector multiplication. It takes this matrix, which is a sort of key to a cryptographic function, and an input, which is a short vector, and multiplies them together to output AX modulo Q. So all the arithmetic will be modulo Q in this talk, so I will not write mod Q explicitly everywhere. You can assume that. So the function is very simple, and what is remarkable is that Haidai managed to prove that if a certain lattice problem called the shortest independent vector problem is hard on in the worst case to approximate, then this function is one way. It is cryptographically hard to invert. And this was proved under the conditions that m is bigger than n log q, which intuitively you can think of it as the number of possible inputs, 2 to the m, is bigger than the number of possible outputs, q to the n. So these conditions are very important. Now, just as a convention, so here I will be using solid colors for matrices in vectors that have entries that are arbitrary modulo q,
and I will use rectangles with rounded corners, shaded color, for vectors with small entries. Think of them as 0-1 vectors, or vectors with entries that are much smaller than Q. I mean, Q is not that large. Q is just a single word number, but then we also want much smaller numbers used as input to the function. Now, these conditions on X and the size of the matrix are both very important. Now, notice, under those conditions, the function is compressing the input. So it maps larger inputs to smaller output as bit size. And this leads to in a fairly direct way to a number of applications, including universal hashing that can be used for extraction, collision-resistant hash functions. The constructions are immediate. You want to hash a message n, you just apply this function to n. You do a matrix vector multiplication and you use it as a hash function. Of course, it doesn't have properties like a random oracle, but it's a good collision-resistant hash function under the same hypothesis as Itai's theorem. And you can also give fairly direct constructions of commitments. You want to commit to a message m, you just concatenate the message with a random string, which is also a short vector, and then you hash together m and r. Now, with a little bit more effort, you can also build identification schemes. And digital signatures can be quite involved. There is still ongoing work in this area, including papers to be presented, or just presented this week at PQC. Later today, Boyan will present the best currently known lattice-based signature scheme based on general lattices. That's the last talk today, I believe. And in a few days at Eurocrypt, there will be one more paper by Cash, Kills, Packard, and Offense present. I'm not sure who's going to present the talk. It's you? Kills. About another lattice-based digital signature and also a hierarchical identity-based identification schemes. But those require stronger assumptions than the digital signatures can be based essentially on the same assumption as IDAI. So let's look at security of this function. Why is it one way? Notice that if we allow the input x to be an arbitrary vector instead of a 0-1 vector, then the function is certainly not one way. You can invert it just by linear algebra, solving a system of linear equations. And similarly, if you let the matrix A to be a tall matrix, have at least as many rows as columns, even if you restrict the input to be a 0-1 vector, again, the function is not one way, because you can just invert it using linear algebra. Then you can show that with high probability the system of equation is a unique solution. So whatever solution you find is going to be the same small x solution that was used to prepare the challenge B. So these two conditions are both very important for the one-wayness of the function. So let's move to the other problem, the learning with errors problem. What learning with error does is to remove those two restrictions. Consider a matrix A which is tall, and consider an input that in this context is typically called S as a secret, which is not restricted to 0-1. So, and then takes a matrix vector multiplication, which can be easily inverted. So this function is very easy to invert. And then the learning with error problem also adds a little tweak. It also adds an error, a small perturbation vector to the output. Instead of giving you A times S and asking you to recover the secret, it gives you a perturbed version, AS times E, and asks you to recover the secret S, or equivalently recover the error vector E. If you can recover E, then you can subtract it from the output and then use linear algebra to recover S. So which of the two really plays the role of the secret is it can be interchanged. So what Rebecca proved is that if you add this error E, then this is again a one-way function, a function which is hard to invert based on worst-case assumption on the complexity of lattice problems, though under the stronger condition that the problems are hard even under quantum computation. Now, the main feature of this function is that as the matrix is tall, instead of compressing the input, it expands the input. And it is also possible to prove that the function is a good pseudorandom generator. And this fact opened up the door for a wide range of applications, starting from the standard one like DRGs, stream ciphers, private key encryption, but also public key encryption. And CCA secure encryption, there was a big challenge at the time to be based on lattices, and identity-based encryption in a standard and hierarchical form. And so on, obvious transfer, threshold crypto systems, monomorphic encryption, though they are not quite based yet on RWE, but they are based on similar problems, leakage resilient cryptography. What is even more surprising is that the number of people that work in this area, I remember a few years ago there were just a handful of people that were working on lattices. And so this area is recently really exploded, and so I was trying, it's a fair attempt, I was trying to make a list of who's writing and working on lattice cryptography these days. I started making a list of just who wrote papers on lattice cryptography constructions in 2010, just in the last few months. The list was way longer than this, there were three or four more lines here that got cut off. And really, it looks like these days everybody, except possibly Miki Aita and myself, is working on lattice cryptography. So, I'm really happy to see the field growing so much and seeing so much interest in lattices. So I will not have time to describe all those cryptographic constructions. I will focus on just the public key encryption under passive attacks, which was the first construction in Regge's original paper and a variant of his crypto system proposed by GDB, Gentry, Pivert, and by Contamitan. So, this is how the Regge scheme works. Still, there is no need to talk about lattices. Remember the LWE problem. So, the scheme is parameterized by a matrix A, which can be either picked by every user or shared and common to everybody, all the users of the system. And the secret key to this encryption scheme is essentially an input to the LWE problem, to the learning with errors problem. So you are given a secret key consisting of a vector S, which is arbitrary and chosen at random, and a short perturbation vector E. And the learning with error problems, this matrix vector plus error operation, is the key generation process. It is used to map the secret key to the public key of the scheme. So under the standard assumption that the problem is hard, we know that this public key generation process is one way. It is not possible to recover the secret key from the public one. Now, the number of colors and symbols on the slides is going to go up pretty quickly at this point. So I did my best to use colors that might be easier to remember. Think of you have this red public matrix, you combine it with a blue vector, and as a result you get the purple color, the violet public key. So, this is the public key generation process. Let's look at how this public key can be used to encrypt. So you want to encrypt a message? Well, you know that encryption has to be randomized. So you start by picking a random vector, R, which again is a short vector. It's a vector with small entries. And you multiply the matrix A and the public key P by this random vector S, but you multiply them on the left, rather than multiplying them on the right as during the key generation process. And this will give you a vector U and a value C. Now you can think of these A and P to be a single big matrix. And we know that under the learning with error assumption, we know that the vector P is pseudo-random. So this AP is going to look like a single random matrix. and multiplying it on the left by a vector r, that's essentially the same as Heidegger's function. And we know that since this function, this matrix is tall, it's still tall if you add one more column. We know that this function is compressing the input, and it will generate a uniformly random output, or almost uniformly random output, if the public key is truly random. So you can use this random string as a one-time pad. You can use the last component, C, to mask the message. So this C is the product of P times the randomness R. And we also add the message to it. And not present in Regex scheme, but convenient in the context of this talk, I will also introduce a small error, R0, which is subtracted from that value. Now, R is a short vector, so if you want, you can think of R0 to be the small number equal to 0, which gives Regex crypto system as a special case. Now, why does this work? It is secure because P is pseudo-random, and if P were truly random, the UC would be a perfectly secure one-time pad that hides the message. And so why can we decrypt? The way we decrypt is the following. Remember that the public key was obtained from A by multiplying it on the right by S. So we can use this same operation and apply it to U to obtain C. And that's how decryption works. You multiply U by S, you subtract it from C, and you will be able to recover the message. You will not get the exact value of the message because of the error vector. But you will get something which is very close to the message because the error vector is small. At which point you can think of the message M to be not an arbitrary number modulo Q, but be a message which is encoded using some form of error correction. So as you get closer to the message, you can apply your error correction decoding algorithm, remove the errors, and obtain the original message. Okay, so far so good. This is the regular crypto system. This is a schematic description of the scheme. We have a matrix A, a public key SE on the right, a randomness, encryption randomness R on the left, public key P, and ciphertext UC. And it has a number of interesting properties that are not necessarily relevant at this point. So let's move to the other crypto system, the GPD crypto system. First of all, a few words about the motivation. The main motivation of GPD was to obtain identity-based encryption in the random oracle model. And the main, so even without getting to the details of the problem, the main technical steps to achieve it are to have a master secret key that can be used to invert the matrix A. And that was the key ingredient of their paper, which is titled Trapdoors for Hard Lattices. And the other one is that in order to apply those ideas in the random oracle model, you need an encryption scheme where the set of public keys is dense, because you will use the output of a random oracle as a possible public key. And that property was not enjoyed by Regex's crypto system. So GPD introduced a variant of Regex's crypto system that has a dense public key space. So that's why they changed. It was not just for the fun of it and introducing one new scheme. So their scheme still is very similar to Regex's, and it still uses the RWE problem as the basis for the security. And it works as follows. As in the previous scheme, we have a matrix A, which can be a public matrix, and the secret key is going to be a vector R with small entries. And so blue is the color of the secret key. I'm using the same letters as before to show some similarities between the two schemes, but this time R is not encryption randomness, but is the secret key of the scheme. So the public key generation process now is less multiplication of A by this short vector R, leading to a public key U, which we know is going to be almost uniformly random, because A, when used as a multiplication on the left, is compressing the input and is a universal hash function. So we get the public keys that can be used in the context of identity-based encryption. And how do we encrypt? Encrypt works by using the LWE problem on the right. We take our matrix A and public key U. We multiply them on the right by a random vector S, and then we add some error if. And under the learning with error assumption, we know that the resulting vector P and C is going to look pseudo-random, and again, it can be used as a one-time pad to hide the message, which is added to C. And decryption works similarly. Remember that we obtained the vector U from A by left multiplication by R, and we apply the same operation to P to get something which is very close to C before we add the message. And subtracting RP from C, we are going to get something which is very close to M, and we can recover the message if we properly encode the message M with redundancy. So these are the two schemes, and the properties of this one is that it has dense public keys. This is again a schematic representation which is very similar to the original regular crypto system. And ciphertexts are pseudo-random, the scheme is secure, and everything works fine. So it doesn't take much to notice there is some resemblance and similarities between the two schemes. In a sense, it looks like the two schemes are just the same thing but with different colors. Or if you want more technically, they are working on the same mathematical objects. But those objects have a different role. We have this matrix A, R, E, S, U, P, C. That in one scheme, except possibly for the matrix A, which is a global parameter in both cases, so the role of public key generation and encryption is interchanged. We perform encryption on the right or encryption on the left, and public key generation on the right or public key generation on the left. And this also gives a swap between the secret key and encryption randomness, and between public keys and ciphertext. So this may seem surprising at first, but well, it works so beautifully that there should be something here connecting these two schemes. And so the naive interpretation is pretty much what I just said. We can think of these two schemes as being syntactically similar, as the schemes that are working on the same mathematical objects, this set of matrices and vectors, and semantically different. So these objects are used in different ways, and there is something deep about the duality between the public keys and encryption, and the secret keys and encryption randomness, which we still do not quite understand. But yeah, there are the similarities at the syntactical level between the two schemes are so strong that there is a connection between the two. But there's sort of this naive interpretation, and I mean, probably what I'm going to say is fairly obvious to anybody that it's lattices for breakfast, like Chris Baker and people working on lattices, is this not the right way to look at these schemes. So possibly this will be interesting for the audience. So this syntactic similarity is misleading, and as lattices have been used to build a lot of the cryptographic primitives, I've seen lattices, in a sense, getting out of the way. There's a tendency to, oh, fine, we found a great abstraction, this learning with error problems, we can think of these schemes just based on matrices. Forget about lattices, which were connected with learning with errors once and for all, and we can think of the schemes just as based on linear algebra. So the linear algebra view suggests this naive connection between the two schemes, but there is a much deeper connection between the two schemes that can be illustrated and is suggested if you think of them as based on lattices, and you explicitly describe the lattices underlying the two constructions. Now, the truth answer turns out to be that yeah, you have to look into lattices and duality to understand the connection between the two schemes. Duality is not between public keys and ciphertext, and between secret keys and encryption randomness. which in retrospect is something that I would consider bizarre. It looked so reasonable and clear by looking at the picture of the schemes before, but there is no way that two things should be interchangeable in an encryption scheme in general. So we will think of these schemes as being syntactically different. So the letters used in the description of the two schemes were the same just by chance. And those letters are describing different mathematical objects, different matrices and vectors. Well, at the same time, it turns out that the schemes are semantically equivalent, in fact, identical. We'll see that using duality and looking at the schemes in the correct way, you can show that the two matrices A and A prime are not the same matrices, but they are closely related. Similarly, what was SME on one side is equivalent to the R prime on the other side. In fact, we'll see that you can throw away S and set E to be equal to R prime. We should have used E in the description of the scheme rather than R, and choosing R emphasizes the syntactic similarities, but at the price of obfuscating really what's going on in terms of lattices. And so on for all the other parameters. Now, to explain this duality, we need to get into lattices, so I'll give a short introduction to lattices, and specifically also duality. Let's start from the basics of lattices, and the basic computational problems used in lattice cryptography. Now, a lattice is a very simple object. It's a geometric set of points with a regular structure. Geometrically, you can think of it as a set of points that are placed regularly in n-dimensional space. In terms of algebra, you can think of it as generated by a basis, by a set of linearly independent vectors, b1 to bn. And instead of taking all the real linear combinations, you take their combinations with integer coefficients. So you will get a discrete set of points rather than the entire plane. And so you can represent vectors as matrix vector notification when x is an integer vector, bx is a lattice point. Now, the same lattice has many different bases. So the lattice is the set of points, not the grid. You can think of the lattice as in two dimensions as obtained by drawing a grid that gives a nice geometric description, but the lattice is the actual set of points. And you can also give mathematical descriptions as discrete subgroups of the space. An important property of this set of points is that you can add up two lattice points, and the sum of two lattice points is always a lattice point. So this set is closed under addition. Now, there are many important properties of lattices. One of them is the determinant, which roughly describes the density of the lattice points in space. You can define it as the volume of the fundamental region defined by a basis. And the lattice can have several bases, but they all have the same volume. And this volume is called the determinant of the lattice, and it can be computed efficiently, given any basis. There are also other properties of lattices, other parameters, which are also defined by the lattice. They are independent of the basis, but they are not easy to compute. And the most famous among them is the minimum distance of the lattice. So the minimum distance, you can define it as the smallest distance between any two lattice points, and since the lattice is closed under addition and subtraction, you can always fix one of the two points to be the origin, so that the minimum distance is the same as the length of the shortest vector in the lattice. You can generalize this definition as follows. Think of this parameter lambda 1, the minimum distance, as being defined as the smallest radius such that the points in the lattice within that radius span a one-dimensional line. Generalize this to define the n successive minima, where lambda n is the smallest radius, such that if you take a ball of radius lambda n, you get n linearly independent lattice vectors. Lattice distance, which is the smallest, the shortest vector, the minimum distance. So if you want lambda 2, you need to take a bigger sphere until you get one more linearly independent vector. That's the definition of lambda 2. That's where we stopped in two dimensions. In dimension n, you can get all the way up to lambda n. So another important problem, another important function associated to lattices is the distance function. If I give a target point t which does not belong to the lattice, you can compute the distance of the point to the lattice. You take the smallest sphere around the target point that reaches the lattice, and the radius of the sphere is the distance between the... That's the standard definition of distance. Now, all these parameters are hard to compute. We don't know how to compute them, and we can define natural algorithmic problems associated to them, which are the hard problems that underlie the lattice-based cryptography. These are the problems which are conjectured to be hard to solve in the worst case. So, for example, the shortest vector problem asks to find a vector achieving the minimum distance lambda 1. So you are given a basis, b1, b2, you take the lattice generated by the basis. Notice, this lattice can contain vectors which are much shorter than b1 and b2. And the problem is, given b1 and b2 as input, you want to find that vector. You want to find the shortest vector in the lattice. So, in the approximate version of the problem, you are not asked to find exactly the shortest, but something which is not much longer than the shortest vector. Now, similarly, there is a problem associated to lambda n. You are given a basis. You consider the entire lattice generated by the basis. You take a sphere that contains n linearly independent points, and you want to find them. Or you want to find something that is not much bigger than that. And similarly, for the closest vector problem, you're also given a target, and you want to find the lattice point, which is as close as possible to the target, or not much farther away from the target than the closest vector. Now, these are the basic problems of lattice cryptography. They are used to show that the high-tie and elderly problems are hard on the average, based on their worst-case complexity. I will not talk about that connection, which is fairly technical and involved. It's probably one of the main achievements of this lattice cryptography on the theoretical side, on the complexity theory side. But I'll be focusing on the connection between the LWE and high-tie problem and average case lattices. So here I gave a geometric description of lattices. Let me define also duality. Now, duality is a very common concept. We are all familiar with duality for vector spaces. Now, vector spaces, you know, they are a collection of vectors which can also be added, subtracted, so they form a group. And you can also multiply them by a scalar. Lattices are just the same. The only difference is that instead of multiplying them by scalar, which are elements in a field, like the real numbers, you multiply by scalars, which are ring elements, typically integers in the case of lattices. So technically, they are modules over the integers. And for vector spaces, the dual is defined as the set of linear functions from the vector space to the reals. And this is a very standard definition. We know that linear functions can be represented as scalar products. So you can think also of the dual of a vector space. Instead of a set of vectors, you can think of it as a set of, instead of a set of functions, of linear functions, you can think of it as a set of vectors. Now, the definition of dual lattice is very natural, if you look at it this way. It's the set of linear functions from the lattice to the integers. Instead of taking functions that take real values, you take functions that take integer values. And if you represent these functions as vectors, as a scalar product by a vector, you get to the following definition. The dual of a lattice, lambda, is the set of vectors in the linear span of the lattice. No points in taking vectors outside of the linear span when all you want to do is a scalar product, of course. So you take all the vectors in the linear span, which typically is the entire space, if you take a full-dimensional lattice. But you only take those vectors that define linear functions with integer values. So you want the set of all vectors such that the scalar product with any lattice vector is an integer. And since lattices are generated by a basis, it is enough to check this property for the basis vectors. and will be set. So what does it mean in terms of geometry? So when it comes to geometry, dual lattice is not such, it's not that easy to visualize in many cases. In some cases it is simple. If you take Zn, the set of all integer vectors, what are the vectors that have integer scalar product with the integer vectors? Are also integer vectors. The dual of Zn is Zn itself. Now what happens if you rotate the lattice? What happens to the dual then? Then also in this case, what it's easy to see that the definition of dual is invariant under rotation, so also the dual lattice gets rotated. And what happens if we scale the lattice, we shrink it a little bit to get a denser lattice? Now this time, instead of shrinking, the dual will expand. So the dual is a sort of inverse. As the lattice gets denser, the dual gets sparser. And up to this point, everything is a fairly natural geometric visualization and description. There are also many properties that are very easy to prove directly from the definition. If lambda 1 is a subset of lambda 2, lambda 1, lambda 2, 2 lattices, then when you take the duals, you take the reverse set inclusion. Lambda 1 dual will be a superset of lambda 2 dual. Also another important property is that the dual of the dual is the original lattice. Unfortunately, that's pretty much where we stop with geometric, at least that's where I stop with geometric intuition. If we take an arbitrary lattice, even in two dimensions, and we ask, oh, what is the dual of this lattice? And we try to draw a picture to get some kind of geometric intuition, this is what we get. And that may look just like garbage. I mean, there's not clear geometric interpretation of these two lattices and how they are connected to each other. Well, actually, if you stare at this picture long enough, after a while, you will start seeing something. So, does any of you see something? Are there orthogonal lines here? No. Do you see anything orthogonal here? Do you see orthogonal? And red. So, it's... Both the red and the black lattice do not have right angles. When you draw those two grids, then you will get the superposition of two orthogonal grids. Now, this related to the fact that the dual lattice was defined through scalar product, and scalar product express orthogonality. So it makes sense to take products between a vector and a dual vector. But that's the only operation that makes sense. If you just look at the points, I mean, it even looks like that I drew a bad picture. You see this red point here, and there is a clear black line here, and I didn't quite place this red dot in the right position. It's a little bit off the line, and that's why the picture looks a bit funky. But no, all these points, the coordinate of the points was carefully calculated up to 4 decimal digits. They are exactly the intersection points, and that's what it is. And the reason that the points do not seem to be placed in a regular structure when you put them together is that adding a point in the lattice and a dual vector makes no sense, geometrically and algebraically. The only operation that makes sense is scalar products. So let's take, if you draw the black grid also, you don't get anything more insightful. So as that's the only operation that makes sense, let's take that operation and let's apply it to lattice problems and let's see what we get. So let's look at the closest vector problem. We are given a lattice in red and a target point T in blue. And we know that in the closest vector problem we want to find the lattice point which is as close as possible to the target. And that's the lattice point V in the picture. Alternatively, you can define the error vector E, the distance between the target and the closest lattice point, and you want to find a lattice point for which this error vector is as short as possible. Now, take an arbitrary lattice vector, Bx. Now, what happens if you move the target by, you shift it by a lattice point to obtain another target T prime? Now, it's pretty clear that you get computationally you get the same problem. If you can solve the closest vector problem for T prime and find the lattice point V prime closest to T prime, then you can also solve the original problem. Just subtract Bx from V prime to obtain the point V, which is as close as possible to T. So, in a sense, the closest vector problem does not depend on which specific lattice point you used as a start, and the computational hardness of the problem is all contained in this error vector E.
you can take the just this error and see what happened when you multiply it by the dual lattice. It is useful to think of the target vector to be the sum of a lattice point plus an error, rather than you first fix the target and then find a vector close to it. So we have this lattice point V, and we perturb it by an error E to obtain a target T. And now let's take the dual lattice. There's no picture because it makes no sense to display it on the same plane. And let's just take the scalar product between the dual lattice and the target vector T. Now we know that a target vector is the sum of a lattice point and an error vector. And let's reduce the result modulo 1. So let's take only the fractional component of this product. So, since the dual lattice has integer scalar products with the lattice points, this scalar V is an integer, and when you reduce the result modulo 1, this part disappears, and you are left with only the product of the dual lattice and the error. Now, this is called the syndrome of the error, because it's a quantity which can be easily computed from the target, but depends only on the error. It does not depend on the lattice point V that you used as a starting point. And you can define this also in terms of cosets. If you take a shifted copy of the lattice in blue that goes through the target, notice the error vector is going to be a point of this coset, and is precisely the smallest vector in the coset. So you can redefine the closest vector problem as, given a shifted copy of the lattice, find the smallest point in this shifted copy. And this coset, this shifted copy, can be expressed in terms of the dual lattice as the set of solution to the system of equations dx equals s modulo 1. So that's the syndrome decoding formulation of the closest vector problem, which is very common and standard in coding theory when you use codes over finite fields. In the case of lattice, it's not as widely used, but it's just the same thing. So it's something very standard. Notice here we have the closest vector problem expressed as the set of small solutions to a system of inhomogeneous linear equations. And notice the similarities between solving this formulation of the closest vector problem and the problem of inverting Itai's function, rather than the LWE problem. Now, let's move back to cryptography now, after this short detour through lattices and duality. And let's look at what happens there. Now, in cryptography, you know, cryptography is based on average case hard problems, so we do want to use random lattices somewhere. And let's look at how these lattices and duality concepts specialize in the case of the lattices used in cryptography. Now, in cryptography, for both efficiency and ease of implementation reasons, it is common to use lattices which are integer lattices, all the coordinates are integers, and the lattices are periodic, modulo q, where q is a small integer, so that all the arithmetic and linear algebra can be performed modulo q without using long integer arithmetic. So we can call these QRE lattices, and you can define a QRE lattice as a lattice which is a subset of the integers, and it contains q times the integers. So since it contains q times the integers and is closed under addition, it is invariant under shifts by any multiple of q. Now, let's look at some examples. So for any matrix A, modulo q, you can define a lattice, lambda A, which is the set of vectors that can be expressed as a linear combination of the rows of the matrix A. Now, I'm using the transpose and the rows just for consistency with the notation used in the cryptography papers. And this notation has been defined and is widely used using the rows of the matrix A. So we have a matrix A, and we take basically the lattice generated by the rows of A modulo Q. So this is clearly a QRE lattice. Another standard example is you are given a matrix A, you think of it as defining an homogeneous system of linear equations, and we take the kernel, we take the set of solutions. And again, we take all the integer solutions modulo Q, the result is going to be a QRE lattice. So it turns out that all these conditions are equivalent. QRE lattice, a lattice is QRE if and only if it satisfies any of these three properties. So these give you two different ways to represent arbitrary QRE lattices. It's not immediate. I mean, it makes sense if, and it's fairly easy to show when Q is a when Q is a prime. In the general case, it takes at least 3 minutes and a piece of paper to show it. It's not immediately obvious. So the two metrics are different here. You can represent the same lattice either as the image or as the kernel of a linear function modulo Q. So if you express it using the language of linear algebra, then it's fairly obvious and it makes perfect sense. But these two matrices that you are going to use are different. All I'm saying is that for any QRE lattice, for any matrix A, there exists a matrix A prime such that the image of A is equal to the kernel of A prime, and for every A prime, there exists a corresponding A. Now, if you use the same matrix A in the lambda definition, in the lambda orthogonal definition, you don't get the same lattice, but you get two lattices which are related by duality. So the dual of the image of A is up to scaling by a factor Q exactly the orthogonal lattice defined by the same matrix A. And the scaling factor is convenient so that you still get integer matrices and QRE lattices. But you can think of these two notations, these two ways to define lattices starting from matrices to be dual to each other in the technical sense of lattice duality. Now, if you look at the learning with error problem, there is a clear connection to the closest vector problem. We have AS plus E. A define a lattice, the set of combinations of the columns of A. We are taking a lattice point, AS, and we perturb it by a small vector, E. And recovering E and recovering S is equivalent to an average case instance of the closest vector problem. And this is clear with a standard definition of the closest vector problem. The main feature of LWE is that E, the error vector, is short, and is so short that there exists a unique solution to the unique shortest closest vector problem. Now, if you look at Heitz function, then using dual, you can again show that it is essentially a closest vector problem computation, but this time using the syndrome decoding formulation. You have this function, A times X, where X is a short vector, and take the kernel of A. So that's a lattice, and inverting the function F is exactly the same as finding a short vector in the coset X plus orthogonal lattice of A. So that's the syndrome decoding formulation of the closest vector problem. So this is just the same as LWE. So these two problems, Heitz problem and LWE, they are just different syntactic representation of the same closest vector problem. Now, that's not quite true. There is a real difference between the two problems, which is Heitz proved this result when the error vector is long enough, is so long that the function is compressing the input, and there are multiple solutions, and there is always at least a solution, no matter what the target is, while in the LWE problem, the error is shorter than the unique decoding radius of the lattice code. So that's the difference between the two problems, and the other difference is that the LWE problem turns out to be very useful, but we have a weaker proof of security. In order to prove security, we need to assume that SIVP, the shortest independent vector problem, which is the problem associated to parameter lambda n, is hard even for quantum computers. So, moving on, we have we have these two problems. They are similar, but with this difference about the size of the error. You can think of them as the same problem, but for different range of parameters. And let's look how all of this applies to the REGEV and GPV crypto system, and if we can make sense of the original picture. Remember, this was REGEV's crypto system. And just a quick look at the picture. We have the matrix A, SNE is the secret key. We perform LWE to compute the public key P, and encryption is done by left multiplication. Now, I removed the decryption, and I am assuming for simplicity that the message is zero, so we don't have the message. Let's just take the public key generation operation and the encryption operation, and let's see how can we interpret them in terms of lattices. Now, the public key generation is the LWE problem. You take A times S plus E, and we know that the matrix A defines a lattice, is the set of combination of the columns of the matrix A. And this lattice can also be represented by a parity check matrix. We can also represent it also as lambda orthogonal of H, where A and H are two matrices with a product which is equal to zero. And so if you think of this as a lattice operation, you can take, you can think of the public key as being a point in the coset of the secret key. The secret key is a short vector, the public key is an arbitrary point in the coset. And instead of describing the coset as a point, as a point chosen in it, you can take the syndrome, and that gives a mathematically equivalent description of the same set of points. And for the encryption operation, you can do the same. If you express the encryption as a matrix operation, is a matrix vector multiplication, where R, the encryption randomness, is a small vector. Now, this matrix, let's call it X, defines a QRE lattice, which is the set of solutions to the linear system defined by X. You can represent it using duality as the lattice generated by a matrix Y, which, if you perform all your linear algebra, is equivalent, is exactly this matrix here, H and U prime. And you can encrypt instead by taking the syndrome of R with respect to the dual matrix. You can define ciphertext as random points in the coset of the encryption randomness. And if you do all the substitutions, you will get that this is the resulting ciphertext. So these are different ways to do the same operations with different representation. Now, if you didn't follow all of this, doesn't matter. All that you need to look is at this reformulation and just intuitively think that, oh, yeah, sure, this is just the same as REGEF crypto system, but written using a different notation for cosets and for syndromes. So this is exactly as REGEF crypto system. And does it recall anything to you? So this is exactly the GPV crypto system. So the public key generation procedure is a matrix vector multiplication, encryption is the LWE system, and we see that there is no swapping between secret keys and encryption randomness. The secret key and encryption randomness is the same. The difference is that A is not the same. The matrix that you are using now is the dual matrix, and you are using the syndrome representation for the public key and the coset representation for the ciphertext, other than the other way around. So you can formalize this as a standard cryptographic proof, giving a reduction showing that as a black box, without using lattices, doing only matrix algebra, you can show that any attack to the GPV crypto system can be translated into an attack to the REGEF crypto system, and also the other way around, and the two crypto systems are semantically identical, provided you use the same distribution on secret keys, which is a fairly natural requirement, the same distribution on encryption randomness, which is also a very natural requirement, and also the same way to represent messages, again, very natural. The only tricky point is that the matrix A has to be chosen in a way that the primary representation of the lattice is equivalent to the dual representation of the lattice in the other crypto system. So is this the case in the original REGEV and GPV proposals of encryption? So are they were choosing H and A uniformly at random. So if you do it, do you get the same distribution on lattices provided you pick the right values of N and K? And the answer is no, you get different distributions. So it's the same, it's the same crypto system, but for different distributions of the public parameters. However, the distribution is not a difference. If you choose N and K to adapt to M, And if you constrain the matrix A to have a full rank, then you also get the same distribution, and you can think of the two as being the same crypto system with different syntactic choices for the representation and different choice of the parameter N. For density reason, the GPV crypto system was using a different value of N to get a dense public key space. So let me conclude with some remarks. So cryptographic functions can be described in terms of matrices without using lattices. And this is very attractive and simple and appealing, but I think it's the wrong thing to do. And I hope that I convinced you that that's the case. And I also convinced you that using lattices is not that hard. You can think of these matrix operations in terms of lattices. And just using matrices can be misleading, while looking at these constructions geometrically can provide good intuition and also powerful tools like duality to get a better understanding of the systems. And this concludes my talk. Thanks for your attention.
We have time for one quick question. Yes.
For the amortized system, where you're encrypting more than one bit at a time, it's not so clear to me what maybe it does, but it's not clear that it's.
Yeah. So it does work perfectly also in that case. And I didn't show it just for simplicity and just to make the presentation simpler, but it works perfectly and is identical. The question was, so there is an improved version of both crypto systems that provides better ciphertext to plain text expansion. And the question was whether what I said applies also to those enhanced version of the crypto system. Syntactically, it is harder to see because when you write it down, the some letters are uppercase and some letters are lowercase. But I worked through the, it's identical to what I did, and it works perfectly, and I presented it also only for the single vector just for simplicity. No, the dense public keys is all about the value of the parameter n. So n and k have to add up to m to get equivalence between the two. Now, the core difference between your crypto system and Regev is a different choice of the value of n. That in Regev crypto system is chosen so that the public key is sparse, but then you get an information theoretic argument in the second stage of the proof. In your case, you get an information theoretic argument in the first stage, and then it gets computation later on. You can even choose an intermediate value, like set both of them to m over 2, and use LWE both in the first stage and second stage of the analysis. And sure, using a statistical proof in one of the two stages is convenient and useful for some applications, but that's the only difference, and it carries out to the amortized version fine. I see you are a bit not quite convinced, and I was not. It took me 3 days to check all the details, but I did. So yeah, it is true. The worst case to average case. So it turns out that both reductions, both Itai's reduction and Regev's reduction, are very robust against the specific distribution on the matrix A, and you can prove the security instead of using a random A, using a dual random A. You can pick a matrix which is obtained by picking a random matrix for the dual lattice and then computing duality, and you can still establish the worst case to average case result. In fact, there is a wide variety of other distributions on lattices for which those proofs can be adapted. So maybe we should rediscuss at this point within lattice cryptography what is the right natural distribution of random lattices that should be used, and I do have a couple of proposals that I'm happy to discuss with anybody, but maybe offline, so we can move on to the next talks.